You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
Do you need a car? Been shopping only to be turned down because of bad credit, low credit, no credit, bankruptcy, or divorce? Guess what? Today's your lucky day, because now you can buy a car, truck, or SUV, just about any vehicle. It's true. Bad credit? Doesn't matter. No credit? Doesn't matter. Bankruptcy or divorce? It just doesn't matter. As a matter of fact, your job is your ticket to your new vehicle. We're Auto Credit Express, and we've helped thousands of people just like you. Antonio H. told us, great company, got me connected, and the day I went in, I drove off in the car I wanted. 100% worth your time. Need a car? Get started now and drive off as early as today. Just text FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911 right now to get started. That's FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911. Auto financing the easy way. Text FINANCE to 357-911.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
At St. Jude, a family never sees a bill at all. It's like the world has been lifted off of your shoulders.
St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
Sometimes writers feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. The only way they can inherit the freedom we have known is if we fight for it, protect it, defend it, and then hand it to them with the well-taught lessons of how they in their lifetime must do the same.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Rick Robinson, one half of the crew of the Jen and Rick Show. She's the other half, Miss Jen Homestead, and we are live right now on KLRNradio.com. You know what, Jen? I was just thinking, we kind of touched on this a little bit during the commercial openers. I think we kind of managed to give the listeners an early Christmas present. Pretty much every live show that we do has been live all week this week.
Woohoo!
So, Merry Christmas.
Yay, that's like a record. And like right during the holidays too. That's kind of crazy.
Hey, we started the 12 days of Christmas right on time. We gave them on the 12th day of Christmas, Kaylor and gave to me. anyway, sorry. All right, so I don't know, how you doing? How's your week been? Mine's been kind of crazy, kind of hectic, not gonna lie. Glad it's almost Friday.
Yeah, mine's been a little up and down. Started off the week really good, and then kiddo got one of those cold bugs going around, and so he's been at home. It's been one of those things where they're definitely sick and they can't go to school, but they're also not sick enough to just lay in bed or like lay on the couch. So it's having to balance that, and they're like, oh, after some medicines, I feel better, and I'm fine, Mommy. And I'm like, no, you're really not, and your fever could come back at any moment. So it's like just been a balancing act and trying to keep him entertained and getting the rest he needs, and then also me losing 2 days of getting anything done that I had planned this week.
NyQuil. That's all I'm going to say. No, I'm just playing.
Yeah, he doesn't even, you know, some of the times when I've given him, by doctor recommendation, like given him Benadryl or something, like it's still, it does not, this kid is crazy. He's never really slept. He's always been like a bad sleeper. He's always stayed up more hours and not slept enough hours compared to what they say kids are supposed to get and babies were supposed to get and all that kind of thing. And so even with something like that, like it helps a little bit, but it doesn't do near what it does to other people's children where they're like, I got 12 hours of kid free while he snoozed away. And I'm like, great, I got 1.5.
Yeah. Now, I mean, I was always kind of like that too. I still am. Drives my wife crazy because I sleep an average on a good night of 4 hours, and she's like, I don't know.
I wonder where he gets it.
That. I don't know. She's like, I don't know how you do that. Like right now, she's like passed out on the couch watching live PD Rewind. She started watching it, went to sleep.
Well, it's like on Tuesday when I got off with you, I was like, I think I'm actually just gonna crawl in bed and I'm gonna go. And you were like, what are you gonna do? You're gonna get 8 hours. And I'm like, I know, it's crazy because you and I both are kind of like. Always going, never sleeping.
Well, don't get me wrong, but when my wife's up, she's like nonstop. But my wife's one of those people that once, like, we were joking because the other day she tagged me in a post on Facebook and it was about the time change. And it was like, the lady looking out the window and it's dark. She's like, what time is it? Is it midnight? It looks like midnight. It feels like midnight. And the husband's looking at his watch going, it's 5:39 p.m.
Yeah.
That's me and my wife.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because she's like, as soon as it's dark, I'm going to bed. I don't care. It can be 4:30 in the afternoon. You know, lunar is like solar eclipse day. She's like, I'm ready to go to bed 2 o'clock. I'm like, it's an eclipse. The sun isn't actually down. I don't care. It's dark. But yeah, so I don't know. I mean, lots of stuff going on, lots of things in the news. You know, the media is making their victory laps over Cohen because he's been officially sentenced to 36 months. And of course, the media, anytime they talk about Cohen, has to throw in the campaign finance reforms and the Russian collusion stuff. But the funny thing is, you talk to people that actually understand campaign finance reform and they're scratching their heads going, I don't even know how they managed to get that charge thrown in there.
Yeah.
Now, you know, and you and I were talking a bit on the break, so I'm not going to steal your thunder, you know, but we were both talking about how, you know, it is shady, but is it really illegal? Because, yeah, I mean, come on, dude, paying off somebody that you slept with to keep your wife from killing you, yeah, that's pretty shady.
Yeah, that's shady. Or if you're paying them off so that, like, you know, people won't know, like, say, for instance, that might vote for you. That's really shady. I think that there, well, I know from what I've seen that there's a lot of arguments about whether anything crosses some sort of legal line, and there's very specific ways in which it can and it can't cross an actual legal line. So I think everyone's just like, because it's shady and it makes us all uncomfortable, people are quick to jump to the conclusion that it must be illegal also because of timing and because of, you know, where did the money come from and all of that kind of stuff. But I don't know for sure what is, you know, in this situation. I think it's been kind of kept under wraps a little bit. So no one has the full story really as to what was actually, the public doesn't have the full story here as to what actually went on, what was actually paid and from what funds and all of that kind of stuff. And if that was a little more transparent, maybe we could know. But it seems that even people that do know, they are conflicted on whether that should be a problem or whether that is illegal or not. But I think for the main thing is, like you just said, for the public, it's like it seems shady. So it seems like it should be illegal. And so it makes all of us go, oh, no, that's not right. But is it actually, is it an entirely different question?
Yeah, and that's the biggest thing. And I think that's one of the things that we need to start having people focus on is, you know, is it actually illegal? Because here's the thing. Just because it's, I mean, I'm not going to lie, it's immoral. But just because something's immoral doesn't necessarily mean that it's illegal. Then we also have the issue of with some of the things that we're now finding out that that Cohen was actually doing during the campaign and during the spin-up of the administration, when he found out that he wasn't actually going to get a job within the administration, he basically started whoring himself out to any company that would listen and started promising access to the White House. So my question with that is, if he was doing that, and by all intents and from everything that I've been able to find out, apparently the Trump administration was not aware that he was doing that, is it possible that some of these exchanges happened before even Trump really knew what was going on?
Right. Yeah. And, you know, and again, unless there is some like very specific documentation that they're going to be able to find, like, we're not going to know whether they knew or not. But we can't assume, I mean, you can speculate that they knew and go, how could they not know? But you can't just automatically assume that they did know and, like, you know, profess some sort of conviction based on that. So, you know, the person that was possibly doing wrong is the one who's getting punished, and that's the way it should be.
Yeah, and you know, the, like I said, the funny thing about that, though, is, you know, when you listen to the media, the first thing they lead with is the campaign finance violation, campaign finance violation, campaign finance. I mean, I heard that a million times today because thanks to a visit from the Flat Tire Fairy, I wasn't able to go to work today. But so I actually sat down and started, you know, doing research and worked on some things that I've been slacking on because it's the holiday season and who the heck has time to sit down and edit audio and do the million other things I should be doing. But so I was, and I also have to say, I took a second to check out the Blaze since the merger. I really don't understand how some of these bigger name shows get such a draw. I mentioned the name in the group, but I'm not going to say it out loud. But I checked out a show I'd never actually listened to before. and I was almost asleep in like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
It was a fairly, It was a fairly big name person, and I'm like, dude, I don't get it. I mean, maybe it was an off day. You know, I'll come back and check it out a couple more times because I never really. I mean, with radio, first impressions are bad because somebody could have been having an off day. But it just, I don't know, the whole thing just, it seemed disjointed.
Or it's like
weird.
The type of thing where like the way they, the topics they choose or the way they comment on a topic just doesn't grab you. So I agree. It can be like, you can't just do a one-off with listening for something like that to make a full opinion. But it is fair to, you know, to form an impression there.
But that's the thing. I mean, I go back and I listen to some of the stuff that and I'm not even talking about the stuff that you and I or you and or me and Dan or even the show that I do by myself. I go back and I listen to some of the stuff that we're putting out, and I swear it's on par or better than half the crap that's getting recognition. And I'm like, I don't get it. I just really don't get it. It's like, yeah. It's like just because people know who this person is, everybody tunes in, and their show is not that great.
Yeah. Yeah, I found that before, too. There are a few that I really like that aren't the big dogs because I can't really stand Rush or Hannity anymore. But there are a few that I really like. But other than that, there are some on that same kind of level as like the Danas and the Buck Sextons and stuff like that, that I'm just like, I agree with you. I go, wait, what? How did this happen? How are you on the, how are you? And some of them are nationally syndicated and I'm going, what? I don't get it, but whatever.
I just think it's funny because I'm like, you know, people talking like, and I was telling everybody this today, I get usually at least twice a month, I'll get a random contact from the station contact form and somebody, they don't even take the time to put an email in. Normally it just says none@none.com and they're tearing the entire thing apart. Like, yeah, Rick sucks. I don't know what he does his show for. Everybody on the station has better numbers than he does and he's terrible.
What?
And have you listened to him for more than 5 minutes? He makes your ears bleed. I'm like,
what?
Yeah, it's like at least twice a month. It's been going on for like the last 2 or 3 months, and I don't know. I usually try not to give it that much attention, but for some reason last night I kind of went off there at the end, and everybody was listening, and they're like, "What's going on?" So I started telling everybody, and I'm pretty sure I know who it is. It's probably one of about 3 people. I don't really care because the fact that they won't tell me who it is when they're anonymously contacting me on a contact
but
form.
That is
when
so...
I give out my email on every single show. Come on, nut up or shut up. Just saying.
Yeah, that is so weird. I mean, that's like kind of stalkerish.
Pretty much.
Who has that? Well, I know who has that time. I know who makes the. I know who. But still, why?
I mean, dude. I mean, I'm the first one to tell you that. Yeah, I mean, my shows and our shows get out in a lot of places, and they go out all over the place. So I mean, we technically are nationally syndicated, but I don't make a big deal about that because it doesn't matter to me, and that's why I'm not. You know, I mean, you read some of these people's bios, and it's like blogger of the year, blah 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 blah, best podcast, blah 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 blah. I'm like, dude, I'm a professional broadcaster, nationally syndicated. What else do you need to know?
Well, what's funny is I get, I randomly will like get a follow from someone and, you know, they'll have a decent amount of followers. There'll be a blue check and it'll say something like that. And I'm going, I have never heard of this person ever, or they might work for, you know, the Blaze, or they might work for Salem or, you know, somewhere in conservative media. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, I've just never heard of this person, but I'll go ahead and follow them. There are so many people out there. So whenever someone, I would just say to anyone, like, listen, like whenever someone makes some sort of claim like that, that's more boastful than just here's my website and check it out and here's my show and check it out. I would just be a little bit wary because there are about a gazillion places handing out those awards and they're often to people that are just within their circle. And so it's not a really good measure of what is popular or good.
Well, because I mean, don't forget, according to TalkAmerica.com, I'm actually one of the top 100 syndicated hosts in the country.
Never right, heard. So that right there just tells you. I'm just kidding.
Never heard of that website until they reached out to me and said, hey, we want to put you on this list. Cool. I have no idea what it means or who you are, but I'll take it.
Right. Well, It doesn't mean that there's not something to it. I just mean there. It's kind of like when someone says, like, if anyone who's had high school kids, or, you know, any of us that were in high school and competed in sports or dance or cheerleading or something like that yourself, you know how there are, like, various competitions in certain obviously football goes through the state and baseball goes through the state, but some of the other sports that don't have the same amount of support and maybe doesn't have a state structure, and then dance and cheerleading and then theater and band and whatever, those all go through competition circuits. And so there might be 22 Texas state championships for band. You know what I mean? Like, because they're owned by competition companies, and it doesn't mean you had to go through, it doesn't mean that they didn't have to go through all the steps and make semifinals and finals. And it was all of these things encompassed, and it was, you know, tons of competitions, and they really worked their way up there. It's just that because there's not, like, a state organized, you know, public school or like an integrated public and private school common championship, then it's run by companies. And so there ends up being quite a few of them. I got to claim I was state champion. I also got to claim I won several national championships. But there were multiple to be had. And while I would argue that at least one of mine was one of the more respected and prestigious ones, it didn't mean that there weren't a ton of other people that could claim the same thing, even though they weren't a national championship on my team, you know? So that's kind of the same thing that happens in the, that, you know, kind of happens in the blogosphere, I guess, and the podcast sphere, and all, basically any of the media, there's quite a bit of that going on, especially in new media.
So, you know what I figured out? We just need to find a way to start our own award.
There you go. And then you can just, you know, kind of garner the acclaim yourself, and you just kind of prop it up and make it seem prestigious as we want to. And then boom, make people feel intimidated.
So I have to say this right as I'm hitting enter. Because even though he wasn't in the room where I was talking about this show, and I hadn't talked about it anywhere else until now, RB is in the chat, and he knew who I was talking about before I said anything.
You were talking about? Oh, about who was contacting you?
No, in regards to the show that I was listening to that was putting me to sleep.
Okay. Yeah. He was like, I think I know which one too, but I think you told me before.
It was in the room earlier today. But he's not in that.
Yet.
So yeah. He's like, you're talking about so-and-so, aren't you? And as I'm typing, yes, as a matter of fact, RB, I was in fact talking about so-and-so. Blah. That's just kind of funny. Yeah.
So apparently, there are some people I can tell just by the way they tweet that I don't want to listen to their shows.
Apparently.
You know?
Apparently, I'm not the only one that feels that way about that particular show.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wait. Now I remember. Remember when I told you that on Off the Rails, I went off the deep end at the end because I was laughing about the Chris Christie? Mm-hmm. Now I remember what it was I was going to talk about, so I'm going to have to make a note so I can open with that on Monday. It just hit me. I was like, wait, that's what I was going to close with. Damn it. Stupid Chris Christie Twitter's version of Where's Waldo popping up everywhere.
Well, do you want to talk about the butt boy fiasco?
I'm not sure what we're talking about, but sure.
Okay, so on the morning, Joe, Mika.
I know what you're talking about now. Yeah, but go ahead.
She was talking about Mike Pompeo. And so today, this whole little controversy happened yesterday. And today she was, you know, conveniently not on the show because she had to attend a family event. But basically she said, why doesn't Mike Pompeo care right now? Are the pathetic deflections that we just heard when he appeared on Fox and Friends, is that a patriot speaking or a wannabe dictator's butt boy? I'm dead serious. I'm asking, are these the words of a patriot? And she was referring to him in regards to Saudi Arabian Crown Prince, And so because he had defended him during an appearance on Fox and Friends. Patriot speaking or a wannabe dictator's butt boy. So, cue the outrage police, right?
You would think.
right? I mean, outrage, fire her, homophobic, full of slurs. You know, she's just insensitive and offensive, and she can't be on the air anymore, right?
Yeah, well, you know that's not going to happen.
Mark Lamont Hill is sitting there going, WTF? Like, what? You know, he expresses some opinions, like thoroughly apologizes, though his opinions are terrible, but thoroughly apologizes. But at least he seemed to be coming at it. He wasn't just like slurring people. He was coming at it from what he thought was like a reasoned and almost academic standpoint. This was just totally off the cuff homophobic slur. And, you know, to me, like, I don't really care, but they've told me I'm supposed to care. And so if I'm supposed to care when, you know, someone on the right does it, or when someone who's even a centrist in media does it, or when a politician or whatever, then I'm going to care when Mika does it on MSNBC, which is supposed to be the most progressive and most tolerant network of all, which we know is a complete farce. But, I mean, if you looked at some of the comments like defending her and trying to say that, oh, she just misspoke, which is what she said. It was a super bad choice of words. I'm sorry. I should have said water boy or something like that. Well, there were a lot of people joking about being offended because they had been perfectly adequate water boys. And that was a perfectly respectful thing to do when you were, you know, growing up and even later on is to be a water boy for a team. But she,
foosball is, you know, the devil, Bobby Boucher. Oh, sorry. My bad.
I know. What does she have against the water boy? Come on. But the butt boy thing, that is such, first of all, it shows her age. That is such an old school kind of, you know, homophobic statement. Like that's such an old school way to like try to dig someone. Like, you know, in the 90s and the 2000s, we're just like, no, I know you're gay. Well, they used to be like, you're a butt boy. So it kind of shows her age, number one. And then number two, it's just like you can't get around that. Like the purpose was to be derogatory and act like he is screwing him in the ass. There's no other way to play that.
Brown chicken, brown cow. Oh, sorry. I don't know.
She did take off today. You know they won't do anything, and you know that people are already over it, and like all the lefties made excuses or just walked or just looked the other way and pretended not to notice. But had that shoe been on, if that shoe had been on Tucker Carlson's foot, or, you know, even Megyn Kelly, come on, look what happened with her with you know, blackface, then Mika would absolutely be run off the air.
I don't know. Have you ever seen Tucker Carlson in heels? I'm not sure that shoe would fit. Just saying.
I don't want to see Tucker Carlson in heels. Thanks, though.
Sorry. Bad joke. But yeah, you're right. I remember Megyn Kelly basically got run out of NBC for a comment that she was trying to say, you know, when we were growing up, blackface wasn't really considered offensive because people just did it. You know, it was a thing.
Well, she was arguing about like, well, if you do all sorts of other things for a costume, why would you not be able to do that for, like, let's just think about it logically. Like, why wouldn't you do that for a costume too? We paint for all sorts of other things. So whatever, like, why do people get so bent out of shape over it? The other thing is, like, I mean, look at what just happened to Kevin Hart, okay? Like, I already mentioned Mark Lamont Hill, but, like, look what just happened to Kevin Hart. He's not going to be able to host the Oscars because of jokes he made forever ago. Look at what just happened to Kyler Murray after he won the Heisman. And I don't know if you saw my tweets, but you know how big I feel about it. If, as a Longhorn fan, I was going to freaking bat over the way the media treated the OU Heisman winner.
Yeah, for tweets that he made when he was like 12 or 13 years old. You know, that's one of the things
I was so pissed off. And I went on rants for like 2 days about it. I was so freaking pissed about the way that they treated that. And yet, here we go. You know, something like this happens. He said queer like 4 times when he was 14 and 15 years old. And it was mostly just talking to his friends, being like, you bunch of queers. And you know, they laid in wait until right when it was his big moment. And then they tried to roast him for it and they tried to derail his career. And it's absolutely unacceptable. And then she's on there saying, oh, is he the butt boy of a dictator? And it's like, oh, well, she's at a family event today. And that's going to be her main punishment, is missing one day. But see, we did something. It's just utter BS.
So just because I give Foo and Ordy a hard time all the time, the following program and the preceding comments contain coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Oh, I mean, it seems like some of the, so many of the things lately, like so many of the topics lately, it's like every show needs a warning because the news is so raunchy anyways.
I mean, you know, I mean, do we really have to start having adult theme warnings though when MSNBC hosts are talking about butt boys? I mean, do they have to have a content warning when they're doing it at 7 a.m.? You know, hashtag asking for a friend.
I don't know. Maybe that's a question for Don Lemon.
Who the hell wants to talk to that guy?
Well, he's gay, so. And he likes to drink on air.
Al in the chat, we called everybody faggot in the 80s, the 90s, 2000s.
Yes, that's true. Yes. Well, you know, and you know what? I'm okay with, like, definitely there were some things that were meant to be derogatory because of what you were referencing. Then it became its own thing. Like, even like when I was in school, like gay just meant stupid. And it was like, well, okay. Once I got to be a little bit older, I'm like, okay, I can see how like gay people would get offended by that. Cause it's like, you basically equated what I am to stupid instead of it just being like, even worse than being like, oh, you're gay, like you're flamboyant, and I'm going to call my friend gay and try to make him feel offended. I'm actually saying gay is stupid, so that's all gay. So I kind of get it, and I get that we have to adapt and our language adjusts a little bit here or there. I still think people are overly sensitive, of course. But, you know, it's just if you're going to have the standard and you're going to say – you're going to make concepts, not just words, but actual, like – you know, intentions and then the supposed meaning of what the listener hears, not what the speaker means. If you're going to have those be, you know, off limits, if those are going to be punishable, then certainly butt boy is punishable and should be held accountable.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned, you know, some of them at one point trying to make the word gay mean dumb, because according to Merriam-Webster, gay initially actually just used to mean happy. Can we just go back to that?
Yes.
Definition?
Pretty and witty and gay. I mean, come on. And you know they've changed that.
You know, careful. Yeah, I know. They updated it.
I mean, not in the actual show. Like, my brother-in-law was in the revival of West Side Story on Broadway several years ago. And in the actual show, they still sing I Feel Pretty the correct way. But when you hear it on commercials or if you hear it as like a re-record of any type, they have changed that now. And I can't remember what it is I used to know. But yeah, instead of pretty and witty and gay, it's pretty and witty and something like pretty and witty and fun or something stupid. Yeah. I mean, just how ridiculous. Like, this is the actual meaning of the dang word, y'all. Like, come on. Don, your gay apparel.
Well, I don't know. I don't think anybody wants to see me dressed as a anyway. I was trying to, the name of the group that sings YMCA suddenly fled my mind when I was trying to make a bad joke. But on that note, we're up against a break anyway, so we should probably take that now to give me a chance to get reconfigured, since I'm still, I don't know, this whole topic has me discombobulated. We'll be right back.
My son was in the army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Welcome back, folks, and thank you, Al, for saving me in the chat room. Yes, I was trying... What just happened? That was weird. My whole screen went out, but it's back now. Okay, so they can still hear us. I just checked the levels, but that was really, really weird. Like, everything just went away for, like, 10 seconds, and then it all came back. I'm not sure if I just had a stroke on air or what happened, but anyway, thank you, Al, for saving me. You yelled out village people in the chat room, which is what I was trying to say before I went into vapor lock right as we were going on break. I don't know, it was just bad, and I was telling Jen, I said, this is really scary because I used to have a really, really good memory to the point where it actually used to annoy my teachers because most of the time I didn't have to carry my textbooks in school because I could... Usually, once I read something, I retained it at least long enough to freak people out. I won't say I have a photographic memory or had one because it wasn't anything that was like permanently retained, but I had enough retention where I could remember something that I read for at least a month. So I could fool people into thinking I had a photographic memory. That was fun. But anyway, anyway, now I can't remember where I parked my car or put my keys at the time, so go figure. Yeah, so we were talking about the whole MSNBC thing, and I'm pretty sure I just had a stroke on the air. So how are you?
I'm doing pretty good. Do you want to keep going into other craziness?
Might as well. I mean, we've only got, about 20 minutes left now anyway?
Yeah, I've got one. This is from Town Hall. I saw this, how I came across this. Who was this by, I think, who covered it as Vespa? He always tends to find some of the quirky things. So... his title is, Are You People on Crack? Almost 30% think Santa Claus should be female or gender neutral.
Okay, so the following program contains coarse themes and adult language. Fuck you!
So, he says... So, here's the thing from... There was a company, a logo design company... surveyed people in the U.S. and the U.K. for ideas on how to rebrand Santa. Why are you rebranding Santa Claus? Santa Claus is age old, timeless. you know, okay, you can do a few different things with him and whatever, but what? Why are you rebranding him? We got Coca-Cola Santa. That's pretty much all we need. So it says the survey polled approximately 400 people from the United States, and United Kingdom. Then 4,000 people voted on the most popular version of the Santa they designed from this very limited survey. Modern Santa has tattoos, a stylishly trimmed beard, skinny jeans, sneakers, and a hoverboard. He's
no
tech savvy,
fucking way are we putting
like
Santa in mom jeans. No,
and
no.
He could easily feature in GQ magazine. A new survey found that over 27% of people asked would rebrand Santa Claus as a woman or gender neutral. Nearly 11% of the people said Santa should definitely be female. So basically, they just want to make him a freaking hipster?
We're not putting fucking Santa Claus in mom jeans. It's not happening.
No, it's not even mom jeans.
It's bad. I don't care. Skinny jeans, mom jeans, same damn difference. No.
No. Mom jeans would at least be better. Skinny jeans is... Mom jeans at least... I don't know how to describe to you right now, but skinny jeans is so much worse. It's so much worse. And a stylishly trimmed beard and his tattoos with his sneakers and a hoverboard and his tech savvy and looks like he could easily feature in GQ magazine. No, they're trying to make him a fucking hipster.
You're not making Santa Claus a hipster. It's these people don't even believe in Santa Claus and now they want to make him a hipster. Fuck you.
Well, you know, that's true. Social justice. Let's just go ahead and turn this whole thing over. We think you're bad for lying to your children about Santa, and we don't believe in Jesus Christ, but we totally want to ruin the image of Santa for you because that's what's good for social justice.
Hey, Ordy, can you go find Jeff? I think we're going to need a fucking swear counter.
We only got like 15 minutes left. Let's just fucking go for it.
Might as well, fucking A.
Everybody that doesn't follow me on Twitter and maybe only ever hears me on air might think that that's out of my wheelhouse, but y'all know better. I'm a freaking sailor.
Oh, yeah, we all know better. It's just most of the time I normally try to keep things PG-13-ish, but oh my God, Ron is freaking out.
Sometimes there's just way too much bullshit. You can't help it.
Yeah, so
man.
I think you've shattered Ron's illusions in chat.
No way. He has been in groups with me for years and seen me come in.
Seeing the 14 question marks and all caps locks? I'm just
He's
asking.
Gotta be being sarcastic. He's got to be being sarcastic. He has seen me come into groups we're in and drop like 10 F-bombs in a row, like, and all sorts of other creative cussery. To express how angry I am about something. I can be kind of crazy, y'all. I can say some things that have some people going, whoa.
You know the most creative way I've ever seen somebody deal with cuss words? You ever see the movie Cuffs?
Mm-mm.
I believe it was Christian Slater that was in it. And it's basically in San Francisco, they have what are called, well, they had, I don't know if they still do, they had what are called special police. It was basically their version of security guards. Well, so his brother gets, anyway, spoilers, but his brother gets killed. He winds up assuming control of a company that his brother was running. And because he hadn't had any official training, he was like being shadowed by a real police officer. And they had this one scene where they're just like going to town cussing each other out in the car, and every other thing is like, and then at the very end, after they do all these creative ways to blurt out the cuss words, you hear the cop say, fuck you!
That's awesome.
That scene makes me laugh every single time. So
that's actually pretty funny.
I mean, they had like train whistles and bands and all kinds of things going off anytime either one of them was cussing each other, and then it just ended with the biggest F-bomb you've ever heard. That movie, believe it or not, is one of the reasons why I wanted to become a police officer.
That's awesome.
I know, well, it's a weird thing to say.
I also like, I either string them, like string words together, or I sometimes make some up. And sometimes it's over stuff that doesn't even matter. Like the other day I tweeted and I was like, I just like make up, like, it's not even just like cuss words, but like things that are like, you know, things to call people. And so the other day I was driving and oh my gosh, there were so many damn Teslas all around me. And so I'm just driving along. And then when I was driving my son off at school, like two pulled up on either side of me. And I was like, so many Teslas in my area. And I had like several people that are like, is this a thing? Do you call people that drive Teslas, Teslas? And I'm like, I do now. and, you know, just silly crap like that. Like, I know that Ordy's right there with me with Slunt. That's one of my favorites. I'm so mad that Twitter flags it now. That's so stupid. It's one of the best ever, Slunt. And I'm trying to think. I don't know. I have my if my brother was with me right now, he'd be rattling off like five or six that I kind of randomly do, especially among the family. And some of that sometimes to get creative to not actually say like cuss words or like not actually call someone like a bitch or something. So I have modified versions of things over the years that I've come up with that have become part of the familial, you know, cursing lexicon. So, you know, it's fun.
Actually, just for the fun of it, I found the clip. It's not going to be quite the same because you're not going to see it, but this is what I'm talking about right here.
Stop the car!
Car, you're going to lose him!
Are you crazy? Stop the car! Are you trying to kill me?
What are you so angry about? All I wanted to do was follow the
guy. Did you see a crime being committed? Did you see a crime being committed?
If we follow him, we will see a crime being committed.
You are a patrol special. You don't go looking for a crime. If you happen to see a crime being committed, then you can take action. Otherwise, your job is to service those people who are stupid enough to hire you to protect them. Now, if I'm gonna get killed on this job, it's gonna be by a bullet, not by a bus. I'll turn this car around and let's get back on your patrol.
You have a limited vocabulary, Ted.
Fuck you.
I love it.
Best cursing scene ever.
I love that so much. Oh my gosh, you have to send me that clip.
Actually, give me just a second. I'll send it to you.
That is
great.
Ron
was asking what movie it was anyway, and that's what made me think of looking it up online. I was like, shit, I can just pull the clip. Because, yeah, that whole movie is like that. That is probably one of the funniest movies ever that was just kind of campy and nobody really knew about it. Everybody talks about Die Hard and how they watch it annually. This used to be one of those movies that I would find time to watch once a year.
Yeah.
Just because of, it was just...
I think everybody should have...
I wasn't actually trying to play it again. I can't get it to stop. I was trying to grab the title and it wouldn't mute. Sorry. Anyway.
I think a lot of people I know have that, like, the non-typical, like, campy movie that they... Or kind of, almost like, kind of cult-following movie. And, you know, I'm not talking about the ones that, like... tons of people all know about, but like, okay, so for you, this is one of them. For me and my sister, one of them is Drop Dead Gorgeous. It's absolutely hysterical. It's awful. It's kind of dark in places, but it's like just so utterly ridiculous. It's got like Kirstie Alley and Kirsten Dunst. And I mean, there's a lot of names in it and it's totally awful. And it's about a beauty pageant that's terrible in a small town, and like the beauty queen ends up getting like lit on fire on the float at the end, and you don't feel bad for her at all. It's hilarious. But those kinds of things are great, and then you get all these little like nuggets from them, and then nobody really knows what they are, and then you introduce them to it. Like, I will probably try to find this movie now and watch it, and like then other people will try to find it, and then you kind of expand the horizons, and it's all, I love that. I think it's great.
It's honestly funny how many Christian Slater movies have like inspired me in life, because the Cuffs movie was one of the reasons. I mean, I was already on that track by then, because it came out in the 90s, early 90s, so I was already headed that way. But it was one of the things that kind of solidified me wanting to do the police thing. And then there's another one that he did called Pump Up the Volume, and that's kind of, which was a little bit older, and that's actually the one that kind of got me into seriously thinking about trying to find a way to do radio stuff, because the whole point of that movie was he was a pirate radio DJ. It was kind of fun.
And then his role in Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves is what really made you find your heart.
Yeah, that was it.
No. No blades, no bows. Leave your weapons here. It's fine.
No, that wasn't it. I'm not sure.
I know.
I'm honestly still not sure. I haven't.
What?
I'm not sure I have found my heart yet. No, I'm just playing.
Oh. I thought you were going to say, I'm not sure I've seen that movie. I was like, what?
No.
What are you talking about?
What movie? Robin Hood?
Yeah, no. And well, no, because I always found his character in that so, like, he's such a, like, grieved little brother, and he's so emotional. And I'm like, oh, God, grow up. Even when I was a kid, I was like, ugh, stop it. It was, like, my least favorite role he ever played. Anyways, moving right along.
Yeah, I was getting a little bit of a spoiler, but not only did I see Robin Hood, I actually sang my wife one of the songs from the movie on our wedding day.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Well, my first wife.
Well, that's a good clarifying moment there. The first wife.
Yeah, well, this is wife number two.
So everything you did it for her until y'all didn't.
Pretty much. That was pretty much exactly how it went too. Everything I do for you until that last time you pissed me off. And then I was
until
out.
It was over. That's funny. Sorry. I mean, it is and it isn't.
Oh, no.
You're happy now, though.
It's funny now because I'm happy now.
Right. Right.
A few years ago, we might have been having words over that joke, but no, I'm just kidding.
Well, a few years ago, I wouldn't have said it if I thought you were in a different situation or in a bad place.
So we got about 5 minutes left since we got a late start. I kind of took a shorter than usual commercial break. So what do you want to talk about for the last few minutes?
Not really much. I mean, you know that Mexico is closing off part of their border where they have a lot of illegal crossings from Guatemala.
Wait, so Mexico's allowed to close their border?
You know, yeah.
Why the
new administration, in the practice of undocumented or illegal crossings over the Suquiate River, which marks much of the border between Mexico and Guatemala, which, by the way, that's said differently in Spanish and in English, so there's lots of dispute. But the new administration has mobilized material and equipment to improve conditions at the migrant shelter in the northern border city of Tijuana, but problems continue because the Central Americans there are frustrated by the slow pace at which U.S. officials are processing asylum requests. So within two different statements, very close together, they talked about how they were going to stop allowing crossings at the border between Mexico and Guatemala. And they were going to, and there's even a statement from someone within the administration about having a heavy hand on it, that they're not going to allow it in the south. There will only be one entry on the bridge. Anyone who wants to enter illegally, we are going to say, get in line and you can, and then you can maybe enter our country. Then right after that, they release another statement talking about how they're going to, improve conditions at the migrant shelters in Tijuana because they're scolding the U.S. officials for not processing asylum requests fast enough. So, you know. Do as I say, not as I...
So was that the same story where they were talking about, you know, the whole give us $50,000 or else?
No, this is different. But yeah, that too. So basically now they want to extort the United States and say, hey, don't worry, we'll leave. Just give us $50,000 each. What?
Yeah, I'm just like, can we really just stop feeling sorry for these assholes now?
This is, I mean, what? Don't get me wrong. Like, mad props for trying, I guess. I mean, that takes some guts to be like, never mind, but we'll just take some money, though. But I mean, players got to play, but what in the world? Who is taking this seriously? Oh, I know. Probably Kamala Harris and some of her groupies.
I don't know.
Also, because she made a big announcement, you know, yesterday that she would not be supporting any bill that included, she did not support the building of the wall. Therefore, she would not support any bill that included funding for the wall. Hashtag breaking news. What? Of course you're not. We know that. This is nothing to announce. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, you know, just kind of This would be one of the moments, if I still had my old soundboard, I'd be playing one of the lines from The Last Boy Scout, where he's like, is water wet? Is the sky blue?
I mean, it's like, it would be, you come out and say that you are going to support it. You don't need to release a statement saying you won't. We all know you ran. Everything that you have done, especially in the last 2.5 years, has been not only, in the last 6 years, has been that you are pro illegal immigration and pro illegal immigrants. But beyond that, the last 2.5 years has been that you're anti a wall, anti border security, and anti any sort of enforcement of our legal immigration policies. So there, and all during his campaign and in the first few months of office, you spoke loudly against him and the wall. So of course we know that that's true. Why are you releasing a press statement on it? It's ridiculous. We know, we get it. You're boring. Go away.
Because it jazzes the bass, man.
Man, I tell you what, this time I'm not going to support it. Wait, when were you ever? You're California Kamala Harris.
Speaking of California, I don't remember if we talked about this yet, but one last thing that we should probably get out of here. Did you know California is trying to pass a bill to tax text messages?
Text tax? Text tax?
I thought about sending that to JD via text, but then I was afraid maybe they might have passed it while I was asleep, and then you'd be yelling at me.
Do you know part of why they want this text tax?
Because they're trying to get poor people more phones.
More phones and free service. So now cellular phone ownership or the possession of a cellular phone and the right and the access to service is now going to be one of the next rights that they push. Naturally.
Why not?
Now it's going to be a right to have a cell phone and a right to have service on.
Why not, though? I mean, we cave every time they start pushing. I mean, look at the Boy Scouts. They cave, like, girls start coming in, now they're going bankrupt.
Yeah, I don't feel bad for them.
You know, I've just gotten to the point where I'm like, I'm done capitulating and I'm done apologizing. Because as soon as you apologize, they eat you alive.
Well, you know what I hated about the whole Boy Scout thing was that there were Boy Scout troops that had allowed had ignored some of the bylaws and had allowed girls in on a case-by-case basis in various different small communities. And you never heard anything about it because they didn't take it to the press and make news about it. There were also girls that were refused that didn't take it to the press and make news about it. But, you know, someone that's the whole thing is they challenged it in order to be able to, you know, try to flip status quo and to beat us with an agenda and with a narrative instead of, you know, that there had been troops in various areas. And I know one right here, like in a smaller town on the outside of Austin, where they had been letting girls be a part of it for a long time and no one gave a crap and no one made a big deal out of it because it just was a community thing. It was a kid thing. And it was like, okay, well, there were a couple dads that were single dads that had daughters and they got involved with the Boy Scout troops and said, can our daughters be a part of it? And they're like, what the hell? Who cares? Let's go camping. And it just wasn't like this huge ordeal. But when someone tries to take it to the national media and when someone tries to make it rewritten, you know, all of their rules and regulations rewritten, and when they want to sue on behalf of gender equality and all of these things, you know, it really wasn't about a specific child getting to or to not do something. They really were trying to do what social justice warriors do, which is ruin everything for everyone in the name of social justice.
Ding, 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 ding. But that's just it. I mean, if you look, anytime anybody apologizes to anybody who's social justice warrior, all they do is flock around them and just devour them until there's nothing left. Anytime they capitulate, anytime they apologize, they just keep going until there's nothing left.
Yeah, who was it recently that wrote something? They said that, you know, their dad had always told them, like, you apologize when you have wronged someone and you have hurt them. And when it's a journalist digging up tweets and saying this is bad and shaming you for them, that's not You're apologizing to a press that was out to get you. You're not apologizing to someone you wronged. You're not apologizing to someone you hurt. So when you give an actual apology, it should be because you actually committed an act against someone that was actually felt by them. And so when these arbitrary things or these offhanded comments, suddenly someone decides to make a thing of whether they were actually offended or not, they decide to be offended on behalf of whoever it should be that is offended, then that's where it all starts to go crazy, and you can't, you just can't win anymore, no matter what you do, because that's not the point. It's not really about getting an apology and then allowing forgiveness for someone for doing something that you seek their apology for, you seek their forgiveness for. It's about outrage and it's about humiliation.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. Anytime they're going after somebody, it's not about actually trying to point out a wrong. Maybe they think it is, but at the same time, because it's been so egregious, at that point, it's not about fixing anything. It's about completely humiliating and degrading that person until they're destroyed. Look what they did with Roseanne Barr. I mean, and look, I said it from the beginning. The right was crazy to glom onto her just because she was playing a Trump supporter on a TV show, because she's a socialist. And she's told us as much.
Right. She's a socialist who happened to support Trump in certain things. But she was not a Trump humper. But she has been fed up with the media. And she has been fed up with the more recent trend of giving sympathy to Palestine and kind of criticizing Israel. That's a big issue of hers. So that is a reason why she has seemed to lean right to a lot of leftists, is because she has been very staunch and very adamantly against anyone who is even remotely anti-Israel or anti-Semitic at all. And so, you know, that's kind of been construed as her being some sort of right-wing nut job, and it's just not true. she's pretty socialist.
All right. Well, since we are now well past the top of the hour, why don't you remind folks where it is that they can hang out with you when you're not on the radio hanging out with me?
Yes, yes. I am Jay Holmstead on Twitter. Check out Misfits Politics on Twitter, misfitspolitics.com. And tomorrow night at, oh my gosh, what time? 8:30 Eastern. I had blinked for a second. Join us for Misfit Mischief, which is some mostly politics-free, good, make Twitter fun again, silliness, memes, games, GIFs, and polling, and all sorts of crazy shenanigans on Friday nights that last pretty much all night. So come join.
You guys should put that on a t-shirt. hashtag Misfits Mischief.
Misfit Mischief.
Hashtag yep. Make Twitter fun again. I'm telling you, that would sell.
MAFA.
Anyway, all right, folks, you can follow along with me on Twitter as well, at RowdyRick73, on Insta, at RowdyRick73, Facebook, Rick Robinson, and you can follow along with the station on Twitter, on Facebook, and on Minds, at KLRN Radio. If you like what we're doing on the station, please give us a follow or a like, depending on which social media platforms you prefer. We are actually trying to build up a bit more of a footprint. We're going to try to hit the ground running in 2019. At this point, yes. The last live show that we have left has been submitted for both iTunes, iHeart, and Spotify. Or I guess all three, not both. Because, I guess we're not supposed to call them iTunes anymore, because it's now Apple Podcast. And they were so adamant about the change that for a while they were locking people out from being able to do submissions. That has been fixed, so the last show that was not a part of Apple Podcast has been submitted today. So we will see what happens with all of that. And we hope you guys enjoy what we're doing here. If you don't, what the hell are you listening for? Just asking. Anyway, we will see you guys. I hope to be back with Dan tomorrow night, but I'm not exactly sure what his situation is, because they had a whole lot of snow. So we will try to circle back around last night or tomorrow night. And if we are not going to do a show, we'll put out a tweet. But my plan is to do one, because it's been like 3 weeks. But we will see you guys when we see you. Until we do, take care. God bless. And be nice to each other. Why do we gotta yell and scream all the time? Just ask it. See you guys later.